So how's everything over there?
It's actually quite a mess, but it's also very well balanced for some reason. We don't have as many cases here. I think we recorded a little over 500 cases for now, and about 9 deaths. But yet we've been put under a lockdown for the next 3 weeks until 15th of April. So I guess it's more precautionary, and that's a good thing. And most people are following it, so that's also nice. It's a nice, refreshing thing to see here in India. But let's fingers crossed. I hope this precautionary measure works. We've been in touch with a lot of the doctors who we've been working with all this while, and they also tell us that majority of it is precautionary. Yes, they have seen a few cases, but it's not as bad as they would have thought it would be. But who knows what the next couple of weeks will determine.
For us, it's just in the next couple of days. We'll see what
Yeah,
happens.
I know, I know. I did read up about that, and I have cousins there. So they've been telling me quite a lot about the situation.
So is this actually, is this impacting your business right now?
It is. So most of the work that happens in 3D printing in healthcare is majorly for cases which have been timed, I mean, which are cold cases. So they are opted in for by the patient. So now, since all elective surgeries have been cancelled, we honestly don't have much work on the personalization aspect. So now we are focusing on how we can make the ventilators more efficient. Basically, the things that is going on across the world, everyone is trying to do something. It's not that easy. There are a lot of things floating out in the market which are clinically inaccurate, and we are trying to stay away from those things. But yes, that's what we are trying to do at backend, to make face masks, face shields, ventilator splitters, or even work on something which can be a side respiratory system. How efficient it will be, only time will tell, but at least we should do something. So now that's what we are working on.
And India has a large population.
We have a lot of people. We've already run out of face masks. People are ready to order in quantities of hundreds of thousands already. And that's how much the need is over here. And a lot of the times awareness is lesser, so pretty much everyone who does see flu-like symptoms is going in for testing, which is not the most ideal thing for hospitals, because then they have to test everyone. So more patient load, less testing kits, it does become quite a challenge for them then.
I think that's the same challenge for a lot of places right now. Okay, so let's do a couple questions, related to your journey on the health in on the healthcare 3D printing side. So you were trained as biomedical engineer,
Biotech engineering.
biotech engineer. How did you, what was it like when you started this journey?
So to be very honest, most of what I learned in my 4 years of graduation has been in my last 6 months of dissertation that I actually did. So majorityly, when I start something new, I'm very used to starting new things. So when I started in a field of biomedical engineering, I didn't actually think of it as a different field. I just took some collaterals. I saw that, okay, it has anatomy, it has physiology, I've studied this. Now let me see what I can do with a different tool. And with the help of a lot of these doctors, surgeons, it became quite easy, because they were ready to explain what is actually needed, because no one was really doing it here in India for soft tissue and all of that. So they also really helped make our journey very easy. My partners, who had been in the business for the last 3 to 4 years, when I had joined, they had been doing 3D printing for a very long time. So they gave me a lot of guidance on materials, on different types of 3D printers, what works, what doesn't work, etc. So with a lot of support, with a lot of people helping me out through the process, all I had to take care of was the clinical part. So it became really easy. It was very exciting to learn something new. I would spend nights, 3 a.m., 4 a.m., just trying to learn something different, or trying to figure out the software, or different tools. And yeah, it's been quite an interesting journey from there.
One of the impression I have from you is you're extremely energetic, so I can imagine that you're pulling all-nighter to learn some of this stuff.
I am. Even now, it's a new journey for us, right? Like everything that I've been doing for the last 5 years, I can't do that anymore. So now we have to look at different avenues of how we can still continue doing something while we are in this lockdown. So this is also a new journey. We are working 14, 15 hours just trying to see what new we can do.
Yeah, and I can imagine when you started this journey, there were some failures and you know, and successes. Can you share some of that with us?
Yeah, so the success stories were obviously in soft tissue, pediatric cardiology, tumor oncology cases, neurosurgery, brain tumor cases, where we realized, then we started thinking that, okay, we should probably go into other soft tissues. So we started focusing on gastro, we started focusing on, say, kidney transplants or something like that, which we realized over a period of time, they don't really require it as much as a personalization input. So then those are the areas where we stopped using this technology. In terms of patient conversion data, there wasn't a failure as such. It was more in terms of understanding what is required by the market and what is not required by the market. And the next thing that we learned was when we started going into product innovation zone. The first time we ever did a spine jig, which basically guides the K wires into the pedicles of the spine, it was a success. We were overwhelmed and we were very excited, but our second and third cases failed, which gave us a lot of understanding of why it failed. We were attending all surgeries. So we understood from them why it failed. We understood where we got overconfident. We understood what are the things that we did not take into account. And then for the fourth and the fifth case with the same people, when we were doing the set of five, we corrected those mistakes. And that's where we actually understood how we should go ahead with product development as well. So it not only taught us about that one product, but it also taught us in general advice what we should do when we do product development. We are very young, 22, 23 years old people, not much of life experience as such. So yeah, we were lucky to have people who did not, who were helping us learn.
Yeah, the other thing that really impresses me is that Anonymize 3D has people in hospitals, in all the hospitals that you work with. Was this always like this, or this is something that you did develop over time?
No, this is actually quite new. We had been trying to push for this for the last 3 years. But 5 years ago when we started, the doctors didn't even know what 3D printing technology was, let alone know its applications. And the management also, of course, was not aware because the doctors were not using it. So over the last 5 years, we helped surgeons develop applications, utilize it more and more in their cases, because of which the administrators now started realizing that, yes, 3D printing does have importance and does do some benefit for their organization also. So 2 years back, we started pushing for certain hospitals. It took us almost 2 years to convert our first hospital, which started last year in December, and fully operational this year from January. And we have another one which was supposed to start 2 weeks ago, but because of the lockdown and because of the travel restrictions, we could not start that one. So that is still on hold. And other two which were supposed to start in April, now again will get pushed down to another 1 month or so. So this is quite a new concept of having an incubation center or an in-house 3D printing lab, where in India, people have been doing outside quite often. In India, this is one of the first few concepts where they're doing it in-house. The patient comes in for surgery. The surgeon sends them to our micro lab. We design, 3D print it, and try and provide it within 24 hours. If there are any special requirements, if there are any products which cannot be printed in that micro lab, it is sent to our headquarters. We print it at backend, and then we pass it on to them. So this is the general concept, and it's quite new here yet. It's not something that has caught up very easily.
Yeah, I would say this is a new concept for all the hospitals all over the world. Do you think the fact that you guys can set it up in India the way that you did is because of a unique healthcare system, or is this similar to every other country?
No, so this is not because of India's unique healthcare system. It's majorly to do with the fact that I wouldn't call the population as the unique healthcare system. Here, majority of the healthcare is not paid for. 3D printing is still not covered by insurance. Okay. And this actually is not very beneficial for our community here. But the reason why we were able to push it in these areas is because, one, the doctors do see a lot of potential because they've been using it on and off. Time restraints. They had to wait 3 days, 4 days for us to deliver the product because one, if they request for a complicated case, or if we have other cases going on in the meantime, then we cannot prioritize theirs. So they wanted something in-house which could cater to their requirements within 24 hours. And the third thing would be the administration. Also looking at it in a way of providing new services to the patients that they cater to. So this was majorly our reason why we got it. Of course, after a very long incubation period. But this is why now hospitals have started looking at the technology. It's more to do with reduction of time. It's more to do with catering to more patients at the same time, because India does not have that many healthcare, specialized healthcare organizations. Mm-hmm. So to be able to cater to more patients more precisely, more accurately, that's why this has been accepted.
Thanks. So, you know, in the last couple of years, obviously you have made a lot of progress in the market. So you want to recap 2019 briefly about what you have done and, you know, your progress?
So one, as a team, of course, we've grown quite a lot. We grew from 3 people to almost 20 people this year.
Oh, wow.
With not only biotech engineers, but biomedical engineers, mechanical, electrical, industrial designers, robotic engineers, etc., across the range. So now we have quite a multidisciplinary team that is working together on different ideas. That's one aspect of growth that I consider. Second aspect would be in the number of, in the types of cases that we are doing. Almost every quarter, I believe, we are venturing into a different product line. So be it in any of these specializations, oral and maxillofacial, orthopedic, etc., but we are venturing into a different application. Mm-hmm. So that is another growth that we are seeing. Third is, of course, the volumes. Because this technology is taking a hike in the country, there are a lot of people who want services also. So there are a lot of collaborations happening. Of course, with our hospital tie-ups, that's another collaboration happening. But there are also individual companies who are more on production. They are also looking for medical services. Mm-hmm. So those are the types of collaborations happening. Mm-hmm. Medical device companies are really looking at this technology because then they can prototype their parts much faster and they can spread it across with the doctors to show it as a marketing tool. So that's another new avenue that we've tapped into. So I guess, yeah, all in all, this is the growth curve that I'd like to describe.
Yeah, that sounds great. Yeah. Well, you mentioned that because of current situation with the virus, it kind of delays your continued growth in the hospital system and also using new tools. If this is not there, let's say everything is still the same, what would be your target this year in 2020?
Right. So we had two targets this year. I mean, we have two targets this year. One is, of course, getting more in-house 3D printing labs like we have right now. Two is on the education space. With a lot of these cases that we've been able to do in the past, when we approached a lot of surgeons, they want to utilize these models to train their fellows or to train their students. So workshops are a very immediate target that we are looking at, because that is something that will be able to help us utilize our existing resources. Apart from that, in the education space, the models that we can provide can be used to teach deformed anatomy to students, to people who are in their specialization years, where they can be taught of what are the, say, for example, pediatric cardiology. What are the different types of cases you are bound to see when you are practicing? So, and how do you try and get hands-on practice on that so that you are confident that when you do see such a case live, you know what to do along with it. So then those are the types of models that we are making kits of. So we have kits in pediatric cardiology, which have 20 different unique cases. Similarly, in orthopedics, oral and maxillofacial, spine, and neurosurgery. So education space was something that we really want to focus on. That being said, the next step would be to make more lifelike education models instead of just giving plastic ones. So where we can have simulations of the fat, muscle, bone, artery, vein. It's a long journey, but we'd at least like to start on that this year.
That's great. Now, I'm also impressed with the fact that you are a female co-founder. I love to see it. Do you have any advice to, you know, the next generation of biomedical engineer or doctors, nurses who are interested in 3D printing?
I would say this is definitely a very scary field in a way, because it's more on manufacturing when you see it from the outside. 3D printing feels like a manufacturing field. But when you actually get into it, you get to enjoy many different aspects. It's not just manufacturing. You get to learn about clinical details. You get to learn about software tools. You get to learn about how applications can be developed and how you can use your innovative ideas to come up with something new every single time. So basically, it gives you an opportunity to think endlessly and also keep the requirements of the people in mind. So as long as we are not scared of the field from the outside, I think people will really, really enjoy the potential and the excitement and the challenge that this field poses to you.
Yeah.
So that's what I'd like to say to them.
I absolutely agree.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much. You want to say hi to our audience?
Hi, everyone. I look forward to seeing you at 3D Heals 2020.